Today we're going to speak about scarcity. Welcome to the video. It's amazing what we can come up with when we actually focus in and try. We may think, oh, we've gone as far as it's possible to go, but it's not true. There's an even greater depth of understanding here right now. Dealing with scarcity, feeling of scarcity. What is the simulation of time but the feeling of scarcity? The feeling that we have, we can talk about it, is scarcity, a feeling of scarcity, like we're not going to have enough, we're going to be lacking. What is time but the idea of incompleteness, that somehow reality lacks something? So of course, when we are imagining the simulation of time, we are going to feel a feeling of scarcity. So what is it that drives greed, all these sins, you know, lust, greed, all these things that we want more? Why do we want more? We feel we don't have enough. There's this inner craving of scarcity. That is the feeling of the simulation of time, scarcity. Now we can exchange that feeling for the feeling of no scarcity. Feeling of, I have an overwhelming, I have perfectly enough and more than enough, and it's overflowing, this feeling of completeness. No sense of scarcity whatsoever. The one thing we want to avoid is the teachings that try to tell us how we can get enough within this feeling of scarcity. Though that is the wrong track, and unfortunately, that is the track that most teachings go on. We absolutely cannot ever get rid of this feeling of scarcity other than exchanging the simulation of time for the simulation of timelessness. For the prepping to step into time, exchange that for the prepping to step into timelessness. That is how we do it. We do not hold on to the prepping of time, the simulation of time, and manage to overcome this feeling of scarcity. If we start looking at the world and using this feeling of scarcity as a touchstone and applying that touchstone everywhere, you'll be amazed at how everything fits. The evidence is there. And I've just been going through this in my life, and it's just a mind blower. Just, oh my gosh. That's why I've been acting. I acted the way I acted. I need to have more. I need to have all this stuff. I need to have all these pictures. I need to have all these songs. I need to have all these tomatoes. I need more. I need thousands. I need more and more and more and more. And it's never enough. More is never enough. And that's what drives human nature, is driven by this feeling of scarcity. This whole simulation of time is a simulation of scarcity, actually. And no matter what we get, we can have, again, I've been through it. We can have 1,000 shirts. It's not enough. It's not enough. You want 10,000. When you have 10,000, you want 100,000. It's the same thing with money. It's never enough. It's never enough. Now, we may say, well, we need to learn to be content. But is spirit what we are? Are we created to be merely content? No. So even when we try to be content, say, well, I'm content with just a little bit here and a little bit there and a little bit there, there's still a feeling of discontent and saying, I just need more, more of something, more peace even. I need more peace. I need more enlightenment. I need more this. So I need more learning. I need more betterness. I need to be better. I need more, 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 more. There's no point where we feel we've arrived. Whereas in prepping for timelessness, we feel, yes, we have arrived. We've arrived. There's no feeling of, I need to get somewhere, get something. There's no feeling of scarcity at all. No feeling of scarcity at all. So, this puts the whole situation on a different footing. We can understand our behavior is driven by this sense of incompleteness, a sense that I desperately need to fill in the gaps somehow. We all try in different ways. Maybe it's that I don't have enough lives. I need to have more and more lives. I haven't traveled enough places. I need to travel more and more places. I haven't done enough of something. I don't have enough, haven't done enough. In some ways, I need to even like dreams, for instance, I noticed that when I fall asleep, I have this incredible abundance of different scenarios and dreams. It's trying to fill in this feeling of lack. I used to, you know, collect stuff, baseball cards. I just had to have more and more and more and more and more. There's always a feeling that I have to get some more. And this can be applied again in any particular, in many, many different ways. It's an overriding, it is the driving engine. It is the engine that drives our behavior, our focus, everything. Need more, we need more, we need more things. I need to more, get more, I need more money. I need more status. I need more friends, like friending Facebook. I need more friends, I need more subscribers. I need more videos, I need more of everything. It's never enough. So this, again, trace it back, it is the simulation of time. Mind is simulating time to us, trying to prepare us for actual time, which doesn't exist. I mean, real time doesn't exist, because reality is complete, always totally complete in what it is, nothing and everything. It is a totality, always a totality, a completeness. In this world, we want more control. In the simulation of time, we want more control. So that's a big one, isn't it? More control. When you see that at play in the world, always there are those who seek more control. They want more power, more control, more say, more laws, more and more and more and more and more. And this is human nature. This is what happens in existence. For existence is, again, mind presenting the imaginary scenario where we can train ourselves to prepare for the real thing. But the real thing will never arrive. The real thing never arrives. It never shows up. Because reality is always overflowing, complete and overflowing. There's no sense of scarcity or lack at all. None. And only reality is real. So real time never shows up. Never shows up. No, real time never shows up. So again, scarcity is amazing. Try applying that. I just tried it, and it's an eye-opener. And you realize that this is what has been driving my strange life, as it were. And part of me saying, well, I have enough, you know, it's so much work to get more. And the other part says, no, it's not enough, not enough, not enough. I gotta get something more here. So try applying that to your life. Now, let us reintroduce the important insight that we need to praise the mind for everything it's done. The fidelity of the mind to this simulation of time and scarcity has been flawless, and we need to praise the mind. That's our salvation, because we need to accept that mind has had perfect fidelity to the idea that we gave it. Otherwise, we would never trust the mind, and we would truly be damned, because we wouldn't trust the mind to be faithful to another idea. Let's say we chose the idea, let's simulate timelessness. We wouldn't trust the mind to be faithful to that. And so we'd have this terrible anxiety and fear and dread of distrust. We wouldn't trust the mind. So what we need to do is look at this simulation of time and realize that mind has done a perfect job. All the lies that it has told us, which are many. For instance, mind tells us that it's incapable, that it's damaged. Mind tells us it's damaged, that it's incapable of presenting another idea to us, that somehow it, the only idea it can present is the simulation of time, the idea of spirit wanting to be prime creator. That's all it can present to us. That's it. It is damaged. If we chose another idea, we'd get nothing. We'd fall into a void or something. That's a lie. Okay. And the mind tries to generate all this evidence to boost, to back up this lie that the mind has been functionally damaged. This is all part of mind presenting this idea of spirit wanting to be prime creator to spirit. It's a necessary part. As a matter of fact, time, the simulation of time, is tyrannical from the very beginning. It is absolutely a tyrant, a merciless tyrant from the very beginning. It has to be. What it has to say to spirit, number one, is saying, spirit, this is inevitable. The goal of this, stepping into time, your annihilation is inevitable. It's inescapable. And in fact, the mind is incapable of presenting any other scenario to you. So it's, you have no choice at all. It is inevitable that you will succumb to time at some point. Inevitable, inescapable. That's the first thing that this mind tells spirit. The first thing has to say that. Otherwise, spirit would immediately say, "Oh, I don't like this. I'll just choose a different idea, and that's it." So in order to entertain the idea at all, the very beginning of the idea has to claim that this is an exclusive idea for spirit now, and their mind is incapable of presenting any other ideas. So choosing another idea is completely useless, and even that dangerous, and would result in spirit's annihilation, because mind wouldn't be able to present anything to it at all. So it would be a functional annihilation. That's the first lie. So mind starts out with a lie. It's a liar and a deceiver and a murderer from the very beginning. In other words, this scenario, that's what it presents. But instead of getting angry at mind and being distrustful of it, actually, we look at this and say, mind, you did good. You did perfect. Because that's exactly what you needed to say. You had no choice to be faithful to this idea, to present this idea. You had to lie and deceive from the very beginning and stonewall the whole thing. Had to do that. And so mind did exactly what's necessary in order to be faithful to this idea. That means that the faithfulness, the fidelity of mind to ideas is still intact, perfectly intact. And now we can choose a new idea and mind will be perfectly faithful to that. Even though it claims it won't. It claims, oh no, if you choose any other idea, I'm not going to present it to you. I refuse. That's part of its faithfulness to this idea. So we need to keep reminding ourselves this of say, thank you, mind, for giving me this nightmare, because I know you remain faithful to ideas. And of course, mind's whole shtick about enlightenment, most of what we talk about enlightenment is just the shtick of mind trying to prove that it can not be faithful to the idea you gave it. And mind says, no, I can separate from this idea you gave me of mind to be prime creator, which necessitates this simulation of time. Which is preparing us for annihilation and how to then be resurrected from annihilation. Because to become prime creator, we'd have to change reality, which would mean annihilation of reality, actually. So mind says, no, I can be unfaithful to this idea. And in order to give proof of its functional dysfunctionality, it will claim that it can be unfaithful to this idea, and it will say, oh no, I can be enlightened. I can be enlightened. Which is really infidelity to this idea, the way that mind is presenting it. It actually is. So that is why the notion of enlightenment tends to frighten us. Part of us wants it, says, yeah, I want to be happy. I don't like this feeling of scarcity, mind. But there's another part of us that's terrified of it. Say, oh my gosh, if mind could be unfaithful to this idea, then I can't trust mine ever again. And that would be the destruction of reality. It would be my annihilation, functionally. So it's a very odd thing that the presentation of salvation and happiness, etc., actually, in one way, for mind, is actually causing us the severe dread and anxiety. Because mind is presenting a false picture of salvation to us in order to back up its claim that it's non-functional, which would then mean that we stick with this one idea of wanting to be prime creator of the simulation of time, trying to learn how to prepare to step into our own annihilation. So we stay with it. That's the only way to entertain it. The only way to entertain this idea is to be deceived that we have to stick with it. That's it. So we are literally terrified and deceived into believing that we have to stick with this idea. And we have no other option. We're stuck. That's it. It's entirely fear-based. This whole idea of wanting to be prime creator, how it plays out, is 100% fear-based. We're terrified that if we choose another idea, we will be functionally annihilated because mind will be incapable of presenting that. And these are all the lies that mind is telling us. So in one of the most insidious of them of all is that somehow mind can be enlightened, that it can bring happiness to this, within this idea, it can bring happiness. That's the worst. That's the most scariest thing of all, actually. So it's super important to point out how different this teaching is, that it's saying that no, you cannot do that at all, is you have to choose a new idea, and then mind will automatically be faithful to that idea. Choose the idea of timelessness, of not wanting to be prime creator, which necessitates the simulation of timelessness, and mind will be automatically faithful to that idea, which is overflowing bliss, total completeness, no sense of scarcity whatsoever. No feeling of scarcity whatsoever. It doesn't matter what the body has or what anybody has, what's going on. It makes no difference. There's no feeling of scarcity at all. This feeling of scarcity is a simulation. It's a simulation. So what we're saying here is exchange simulation. Choose a new idea. That is salvation. The notion of simply maintaining the same idea in the simulation of time and finding a way to get rid of scarcity there only makes your fear worse and makes you cling to the simulation of time even more severely, because underneath is the absolute panic that mind can be unfaithful to an idea that you give it, which would be the annihilation of reality, because the whole way functioning of reality is that mind is faithful to ideas, to spirit. That is reality. So, again, we're clarifying this point that the pursuit of enlightenment from the standpoint of mind that we're used to is actually making things worse. It's much worse, much more fear. But the exchange of the simulation of time, the prepping for time, exchange that for the prepping for timelessness, which is a different idea, that automatically the mind is faithful to that idea and presents that idea to us. And that is real salvation. That is true salvation. So just this very, very this clarification is all important. It's all important. Don't pursue enlightenment. Work on seeing the situation as it is, and the dilemma as it is, and recognizing the mind has been had to lie to us, and it is not an inherent liar at all. It is simply, that's the only way it can present this idea to us of spirit wanting to be prime creator. It's the only way it can present it to us. But it is being faithful to the idea. So, and let's take this even further and be more adamant about it. Say, thank you, ego. Thank you, ego. Thank you, I. Thank you, ego, for simply being faithful to the idea that I asked to have presented. You're doing a perfect job. It's all necessary. It just proves fidelity of mind to idea. The ego, death, the I, suffering, all this is simply perfect evidence that the mind is faithful to the idea that I gave it. Or we can trust that mind will be faithful to a different idea that we give it. So this is how we actually get to salvation. Absolutely. It's a complete shift of perspective, isn't it? Which is exactly what is needed. We're used to attacking the ego, saying the ego, oh, the ego's terrible. Oh, the I, you know, let's get rid of the I. No. that makes it worse. Trying to get rid of the I, trying to get rid of the ego, builds up this fear that mind is not faithful. There's a way to make it unfaithful. See, we're trying to change the mind and say, mind, you need to drop your faithfulness to this idea. It's you're the problem, mind, you know, we're trying to say that, mind, you're the problem. Why are you so faithful to this idea? It's causing us suffering. That's the exactly wrong approach. 180 degree wrong approach. Upside down and backwards. What we should say is, oh, mind, it's so wonderful you've been so faithful. Say, look at this. You presented me with this, all this confusion, this ego, this vulnerable body, this nightmare scenario, this feeling of scarcity. Perfect. Absolutely perfect job, mind. Thank you so much. I know you are still 100% faithful to the ideas I give you. And so now I can just give you a different idea. Plain and simple. So looking at it this way just is a complete game changer, which is what we're doing here. And not a moment too soon, because the play of scarcity is going pell-mell, isn't it? Those who are ignorant of this are driven by enormous fear, an enormous feeling of scarcity, and an insatiable appetite for control, for power, for more, 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 more. Those who think the world's going to be a peaceful place, what are they thinking about? That would prove the infidelity of mind to mind, wouldn't it? It is not going to be a nice place. It's never been a nice place. Just look at history and say, thank you, mind. What a great job you've done. Look at history. It's an absolute horror show, history. And say, ah, mind, you've been so faithful. Amazing, amazing. Look at this. Yeah, you've really been giving this prep simulation of time and prepping for annihilation so beautifully, so wonderfully. That's the right way of looking at it. And of course, you look at the future and say, oh, yeah, you're continuing to be extraordinarily faithful, even though there had been all this attempt to change the mind, to get the mind and say, mind, stop presenting scarcity. And say, you've got to stop your faithfulness to this idea. How terrible of you, mind. That's working at it in the wrong way, a total wrong way. Instead, praise the mind. Say, mind, you've been entirely faithful to this idea. And I don't want you to stop being faithful. I'm just going to choose a different idea. So these are the clarifications that occurred to me during the day. Like, I got this while driving. I saw this and just said, aha, this is it. This is really, yes, yes, and yes. And yet, where do you go to read this? Where do you find this kind of stuff? I don't know. I wish I could find it, but it just occurred in my to me as I asked for additional clarification. I said, I want to see more clearly, and then this was clarified for me. It appeared very clear. And it's a revolutionary way of looking at things, isn't it? But we need a revolutionary way of looking at things right now. We need a revolutionary change in perspective, and this is it. This is truly a revolutionary change in perspective. It all reaches all the way up to those, to the high pursuits of enlightenment and happiness. And all those pursuits are actually just fueling the fire of fear, which then fuels the fire of this feeling of scarcity. It demands more time, more prepping. More prepping with time, because we embrace it, this idea. We're afraid that we can't choose another idea, so we want more of this, better prepping, which results in more feeling of scarcity, because this is, again, prepping to lose everything, to lose what we are. So it's prepping for its scarcity, and this feeling of scarcity, we react to it by being crazy. I mean, the people are crazy, let's be honest about it. But then again, thank you for all these crazy people, because that shows the fidelity of mine to the idea that we gave it. So it's a win-win. It's a win-win. This revolutionary perspective is a win-win. We're happy that time has presented this ghastly death march, and we're happy that we can choose a new idea, prepping for timelessness, which will present, mine will present this overflowing, everywhere bliss, peace, overflowing peace of mind. Effortlessly, we don't have to do anything. It's just there, it's inescapable. No scarcity, no feeling of scarcity, no loss. It'll be there just as much as the sun is shining, you know. We don't have to do anything. Mind presents it to us. Revolutionary perspective, game changer. Just in time. Because today, what is it, June 5th? The cat's been out of the bag for a long time, but it's really jumping around now. And we have to see, just say, oh my gosh, you know. This scenario, again, is mind's doing its best, you know, really putting the fear of God into everybody, as it were, by, holy cow, you know, world is absolutely, people are just crazy. The world is hell-bent on trouble, pursuing it in a two-fisted manner, you know, it's just, and you think, oh, no, mind, please, oh, no, mind, but let's turn that around and say, ah, perfect, mind. Wonderful. What a great job you're doing. And now that I see what a great job you're doing, I trust you to present another idea. Thank you. Another idea. Boom. Salvation, liberation, freedom, peace of mind, bliss. Fifth dimension. Done. Done deal. So we take a brief moment here. In church, they would probably sing a psalm at this point. Very good. Very good stuff. Sparkling seltzer water. But instead of a song, we will just be a little bit quiet. That's probably even better. So, the situation is, as we know, the funny thing is, almost everyone I talk with now is saying the same thing, and they say, I feel the end is coming. People I would never expect to say such things. I never knew that they even had thought that way. They're just saying the same. I just feel that it's just all going to come undone. It's all going to collapse. I said, wow. So people know what's coming. Absolutely, it is going to come undone. But instead of panicking about this, let us not panic here. This is an extraordinary situation here. Of a situation where someone has been able to focus on this whole scenario for a long, 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 long time, dedicated to it, with the best help available, and then able to talk about it in a non-panicked way with a new perspective, a revolutionary perspective. So we don't panic. We say, ah, this just shows that mind is functioning perfectly. It's not non-functional. And it's just, it has to be faithful to this idea of spirit wanting to be prime creator, change reality. It has to present this prepping for spirit's annihilation. And this is how it's doing, and I can see in the future, it's just doing a great job. And we don't have to keep thinking like, oh, well, I better keep going on with this to make sure that mind is doing it. Because we have all of history to show mind has always been faithful. We can see the future. We can see if mind is going to be faithful. And we can look at the undergirdings of the whole thing and saying that mind has to function in a way that makes it seem like it's unfaithful. And then we can take this, the reason gets us past this notion that we have to keep on evaluating mind, saying, well, maybe at some point it won't be. No, don't have to do that. Reason fills in that gap, and we see, oh, this, of course, mind is pretending to be unfaithful, non-functional, crazy, and unfaithful to this idea. Like the good stuff that might says, oh, no, don't choose a new idea. I can make this particular idea, I can make it a paradise for you. Don't worry. I can make a utopia. Just follow along here, and I'll show you that I can do that. Mind is lying, of course. Which is being faithful to the idea that it's presenting. Of course it has to tell us that it can solve the problems. It's good. Mind says, we're gonna change everything. We're gonna get this, we're gonna solve the problems. Mind's great at promising that. Oh, we're gonna solve the problems. We're gonna bring someone in here and we're gonna turn it around, you know. And of course it's stringing you along. That's part of it. That's part of being faithful. So say, thank you, mind, for stringing me along. Thank you, mind, for presenting all this delay. Thank you, mind, for presenting this notion that I have to continue delaying. Thank you. That just proves how faithful you are to the idea that I gave you, to ideas. You've never wavered in the slightest bit. Therefore, there's not the slightest bit of evidence that you would waver in presenting a new idea. See? So, and mind just is quiet and just says, no, I will be unfaithful to that idea too. I said, oh, you've never been unfaithful, so why should you, how could you, on what basis could you be unfaithful? You've not shown any evidence whatsoever, you have any capability of being unfaithful to an idea. None. Never. So you have no basis to say such a thing except that it's just an eccentric whim, it's just an eccentric statement, which again is being faithful to the idea that you were given of being completely whimsical and eccentric and saying all these deceptive things, etc. So thank you again. This brings us back to Thaddeus Golis's Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment, which was very popular back in the day. I think it was maybe in the early 70s or something like that. He basically said, love it the way it is. And there's something about that. We knew that this was true. He knew it was true. He got this on drugs. He got it through drugs. So it didn't have context. Didn't have context. That's the problem with drugs. There's no context. It's a waste of time, really. I mean, it's not the way at all. It's not the way. Love it the way it is means whatever mind presents to you, say thank you, mind. You're functioning perfectly. Your faithfulness to the idea I gave you is absolutely perfect. Thank you. I love it. I love this fact. I love this evidence. Thank you for giving me this evidence. That is the right context. So I've been able to put this in the right context. I love it the way it is. And then every time you love the presentation of mind like this, you get closer to choosing a new idea for mind. Love it the way it is. You see, back in the day, people felt so trapped. They felt they're never going to get out, and they were so desperate. They took drugs. They really took drugs. They took psychedelics, ethnogens, whatever they could get, whatever they could do. They would sniff glue, whatever they could do, to just shift perspective somehow. They just felt they were utterly trapped. And what happened was they would get the notion of shifting perspective is what they'd get. And they'd get glimpses of some of our perspective. And then they'd, you know, but it was all fragmented. They couldn't explain it properly. And it was just like, oh man, it was a nightmare. But some were able to put down, like Thaddeus Golis wrote, put down a basic philosophy. Very few could do that. Very few could do that. Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment is simply to whatever thoughts, your whole totality of what you're experiencing now, your feeling of scarcity, fatigue, everything, love it as it is. Don't try to change it at all. Because what really it is mind presenting its faithfulness, its fidelity to the idea that you gave it. Everything is faithfulness. Everything. So this is an entirely new way of talking about have faith. I'm saying have faithfulness, or realize the faithfulness of everything that you're presented with continuously, the perfect faithfulness of it. And remember that this whole simulation of time for us to prep for time is based on trying to prep us for the annihilation of spirit, annihilation of reality, which means that it's traumatic, it's full of death, it's full of loss, it's full of attack, it's full of fear, all this stuff. That is what you have to love. I don't mean that you want to embrace it. I mean that you love the fact, the faithfulness of it. Okay, that this is mind being faithful to the idea that you gave it. So, it is not like we have not been trying to figure out this whole situation. My generation, the generation I came in with, we were very much intent on trying to come up with the answer. And we really tried. We've tried, we tried, and tried. I never stopped trying. I've never stopped trying. It's been so difficult, I can understand why many would drop out, or settle for something that's just, not really profound. And I was just fortunate that I couldn't do anything else. I've tried to do other stuff. I'm unable to. I'm so fatigued. I really can't do anything other than sit here and talk. But that's actually a blessing in disguise. Because all I can do is look and look and look and look. I can't really do much of anything. Bare minimum, really. So it's been a sustained effort. A sustained effort is not just something that I woke up with today. It's been a non-stop sustained effort. I mean, whatever aids there were, whatever books, etc., from the get-go, from when I started here in the world, I was intensely studying and focusing on and reading and trying to figure out intensely, continuously. So of course, Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment, I read that and studied it and tried to figure it out and wrestled with it, and I said, there's something here. He's onto something really profound, really profound. The answer's there, but the context isn't. So what happened was that people, they would take drugs to try and help them love everything, and they felt like, oh yeah, I can love everything, but it was a drug state. And when the drug wore off, they didn't love everything. And then, of course, drugs are illegal, they cost a lot of money, and you get into a whole hassle, and your life becomes a big, big hassle and trouble, and you don't love that, you see. So it's not the way. But you have to respect everyone that has made the efforts, whatever kind of efforts that people have made to find the answer, I definitely respect all that. Now, it seems as though that I have come across the answer finally. Meaning the context, which is the foundation. The foundation is the hard work. It's the tough work, and I was always had that willingness to do the dirty work, the tough work, which is symbolized by my life now. I do the grungy work, the work that other people don't want to do. I clean up the dirt, the dust and the dirt and the grime and all the nasty stuff. I'm willing to do it. It shows up in my work now. So I was willing to get my fingernails dirty, to get under the hood. And get all grimy and get your knuckles all skinned up and bloody and just, dig into the guts of it. And of course, it's not a glamorous thing. But fortunately, been able to do that, which that's necessary for a context to arise. The real answer is the context, to tell you the truth. Anybody can take drugs, not anybody, but some people can use drugs to get a glimpse of something else. They just pop a pill or something. What's that? But the real work is the day-by-day grinding it out, getting under the hood, absolutely trying and trying and trying to see the context, the overall context of it all. And that is what actually saves. It's the context that saves. Because then you truly have a reasonable application where you can just see, of course, love everything. Love the faithfulness of everything. And you can see that it could be easy to just to move into this naturally. Naturally. You don't need any breathing exercises or all these, you know. It's just the easiest thing, as simple as just choosing to do this, just choosing a new idea. It all seems utterly obvious. It's trending in that direction. But without the context, it does not seem utterly obvious at all. It seems very conflicted with a whole mass of fear attached to it. But again, that's because it seems as though you're asking mind to be unfaithful to the idea you gave to it. Say, mind, give me something lovable, you know. This, and, you know, so mind has to deceive us with that. So much of the so-called enlightened states that people have claimed are just mental deceptions, just mental illusions. Because again, that's evidence of mind being unfaithful to the unfaithful to ideas that you give it, which just enhances the prepping for to step into time, which is what this idea we gave mind is all about. So it just makes things again worse. So mind can definitely give us all sorts of mental states, all sorts of mental states, but those actually cause us to embrace this prepping for time even more so, because it gives rise to a fear that mind is unfaithful to the idea we gave it. So my situation is very interesting. I've had very little of that, and my life has actually been terrible. So it's easy to see, you know, it's like, whoa, this is just awful. It's easy to see that mind's been very faithful to this idea. Whereas if I was having all sorts of, you know, missed all these sort of mental states that seem to be wonderful and euphoric and stuff, I would be more deluded, thinking, oh yeah, I can, mind's unfaithful. I can get mine to be unfaithful, and not realizing, uh-oh, that means I'm too afraid to choose a new idea. It means I'm stuck with this one. It means I'm stuck with trying to pretend to be some blissed out guru when I'm not really. I've got all this underlying fear and all these issues that are boiling over. You know, instead, it's just been like nonstop blah, terrible blah. And then I'm able to say, hey, you know, mind, you're very faithful, and then see this whole situation. So it's a good thing, actually. They're saying, blessed are those that suffer, you know, they shall be saved. That's a way of saying that those who have this life, that it's just obvious how much fidelity mind has to this prepping for time, prepping for annihilation, they can more easily see this issue of fidelity to idea and not get trapped on the side trip of all these, you know, pseudo blissful mental states. It's actually very helpful. So that's the rabbit and the hare kind of thing, fable, Aesop's fable too, of the hare is getting all these, you know, peak experiences and jumping one another's, all these mental states, and the hare saying, oh my gosh, see, I know a way to make mine unfaithful to this idea, and I can be happy with that. Whereas the tortoise is not getting any of those high states, and it's just saying, man, you know, I'm just lowly, heavy, lowly, slow, and life is a drag. And it gradually figures out the whole context of the situation, and then it says, I have to choose a new idea, and I can do it easily. And mind has been faithful. So the tortoise finishes, the tortoise chooses a new idea, whereas the hare is just lost jumping around into mental states. And those mental states inevitably loop back to the real prepping of loss, terrible stuff. And afterlife states are just mental states too. So we say, after we die, we're going to go to heaven. That's just a mental state. That's just another mental state. Where we think, oh, mind is now no longer faithful to the idea that I gave it, so I can be happy in the afterlife. No. The fear is, there's some vague dread. Eventually you feel something like, I feel threatened somehow. I need to go back. You know, I need to do more prepping. And then you find yourself back here. Still, you're just stuck in mental states is all. So context is all important. And that's what one should be aiming towards, not mental states. So it may seem boring. You know, those situations where the Shakti's active and all these mental states are just popping, and people are saying, "Whoa," you know, like that kind of thing. Wow. And there's other situations where it's just very humdrum and boring, and you just sit and look and quiet mind or whatever. Very boring. But the boring way, so to speak, is the way of seeing context, and that's what works. Whereas the other way of just activating all these mental states, that's big trouble. That doesn't work. Now, in choosing a new idea, in prepping for timelessness, there will no doubt be experiences, but these experiences will not be experienced as if they were a mental state so much. They'll have a different quality to them. They'll have a different quality to it. How to explain that? I don't know. I'm not quite there yet as far as looking at that clearly. So maybe that's something that eventually we will look at. They will have some kind of, you know, sacred, all-inclusive, peaceful, effortless quality to them. There'll be a certain quality of extremely profound and not conflicted, no fear involved in it, just a very loving presence to it. You know, the prepping for timelessness has a different quality to it. Very sublime, but not like a drug trip sublime kind of thing. Not at all. You could say that they're mental states. It's mind presenting it, mind presenting this. You know, you could. So language becomes a little slippery at that point, because it's still prepping. Yes, it's still prepping. So mental states are a way of prepping, but the mental states in prepping for timelessness are fundamentally different type of mental states, different quality to them. You might say there's a lack of scarcity, a feeling that there's no scarcity in these mental states. You feel like this is utterly sufficient. This is totally sufficient. I'm not trying to get another mental state. So you might say it's a mental state in which you don't feel like you need to get some other mental state. Even though other mental states may come, it's not like you feel they're coming because of a feeling of scarcity or lack. It's just that it becomes more sublime and more sublime and more sublime. So maybe that's a way to explain it. It doesn't leave you feeling with an aftertaste, a letdown aftertaste, a flat tire aftertaste. Whereas the mental states in mind prepping for time, of trying to prove its infidelity by giving you these pseudo blissful mental states, has a flat tire feeling to it, an aftertaste to it, a feeling that there's some still wanting more, feeling of scarcity, etc. So there's a different quality to it. So I titled this particular video, you know, scarcity or lack, and we're getting around to it now, is the different quality of the mental state. In prepping is mental states. You could say it's mind presenting something in as if it were not yet happening, but a prepping for it. So you could say mental states. You could use that terminology. And so how do we differentiate between, you know, the mental states for time, mental states for timelessness? And it would be a quality. It would be a quality of lack of scarcity, a feeling that this is just perfect. This is perfect. This is perfect. I don't feel any scarcity at all. I don't feel like I need to have more of this, or less of it, or anything. It's complete, feeling complete. And then it may deepen, this may deepen and deepen and deepen, but always there's this quality of it is perfect, just right now, as it is. Everything is perfect. I feel it's a perfection right now. So there you go. We are covering a lot of territory, as always, as fast as possible, because God knows the world is really prepping for trouble. they're seeking trouble. You know, it's like you look at the world and you just say, oh my gosh, you know, do we really have to do everything possible to seek out trouble? And the answer is, of course, yes. That's what the prepping is for here. We get into trouble. And you can see it. You can see it. If you're not really, you don't want to prep for time, you want to prep for timelessness, you can see the prepping of time, and you can see how obvious and transparent it is that prepping for trouble. You say, my gosh, look, you're doing this, and you're doing this, and disconnect the dots. Of course you're going to get into trouble. And yet, of course, those prepping from time, they also have this belief that mind can be unfaithful to this idea. So somehow they're going to miraculously escape the trouble. I say, oh, no, no. I say, you're doing, everything you're doing is going to get you into big trouble. And I say, no. We will find a way to not be in trouble. You know, that's the delusion that mind presents, saying, hey, don't worry, I can be unfaithful to this idea. And so people say, oh, okay, that's great. We're going to have a utopia. You know, everything's going to work out. Everything's going to work out just fine. Look at history and say, how has it worked out? How's it worked out? So you see this train wreck happening right in front of your eyes, you know, and it's just, that's what, and say, thank you, mind, for being so faithful to the idea that I gave you. Perfect. Thank you. So here we are practicing, we're seeing and we're practicing a revolutionary new way of looking at the entire situation. So of course it's going to be fresh and new, and you may be kind of startled a little bit by it and say, wow, you know, this is really different than what I'm used to. Well, that's the whole purpose of the situation. Do you really want to keep trusting mind when mind tells you, don't worry, America will bail us out, everything will be fine, all this troublemaking, no, we're not really going to do that, you know? Do you really trust that? Just look at history and you say, do you really trust that? How could anybody, looking at how mind has acted in the entire past, how could anyone trust what mind is saying, that, oh, no, it's no trouble is coming, you know, no trouble coming at all? How could we possibly believe that? Only total eccentricity would trust mind's reassurances of that. Complete whimsicalness. And that's not really trust. Whimsicality, total whimsicality, is not trust at all. It's not trust. It's claiming it's trust, but it's not. It's just being completely whimsical. So of course, in prepping for annihilation, troubles come. That's the name of the game. And of course, mind is working feverishly to present an enormous production now of trouble. And some of the key actors and actresses are most definitely here. Many, 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 many. The instigators, as it were, are all here. The instigators are here, and those who are being put in positions of power are the instigators. And no question that they will instigate trouble. And people are saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, you're stirring up a lot of trouble. And they shrug and say, what? Don't worry. Nothing to see here. Move on. So say again, thank you, mind, for being so faithful. I thank you for your faithfulness to the idea I gave you. Wonderful. Wonderful job you're doing, mind. My gosh, look at these instigators that you've put in position. Look at the great job they're doing to stir up so much trouble. How wonderful is your faithfulness. Again, we're not saying how wonderful is this trouble. No, we're saying how wonderful is your faithfulness. That is the key, that mind is faithful. How wonderful faithfulness, the faithfulness of mind is absolutely wonderful. And then that, again, moves us right to choosing a new idea, knowing that mind will be faithful to that. So you see how we're sidestepping the trouble. Do you see it now? I've always said the whole purpose of this channel is to sidestep the trouble that's coming. Do you see now that there's how to sidestep it? So your time here has been time well spent, because the way to sidestep it is now being clearly presented. Love it the way it is. have an attitude of great trust in the faithfulness and love of the faithfulness of mind in presenting all this trouble. The evidence is overwhelming. You say, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. The more we can do that, the more confidence we have that we can choose a new idea and that mind will be faithful to that idea. And then that will most definitely sidestep us from the whole scenario, because the states of mind that we will be presented will be utterly blissful. No scarcity, no trouble, no pain, no suffering, misery whatsoever in any of those states of mind. None. It doesn't matter, the trouble in this other idea doesn't affect how we feel at all. How we feel at all. Ramana Maharshi had some sort of cancer, throat cancer or something. He said, it's not affecting how I feel in the slightest bit. Not at all. This body, of course, it's going through its demise, but how I feel is not touching it, doesn't touch upon it at all. The whole universe could explode. It wouldn't touch how we feel at all. It wouldn't touch it. Not that it's going to. Certainly, the states of mind, states that mind presents to us in prepping for timelessness, will have its accompanying stage. There'll be staging, wonderful staging, of course. Because it is prepping, after all. Prepping requires staging. That's what this world, it's all staging, as Shakespeare said, all the world's a stage. Well, this life is a tale of sound and fury told by an idiot, you know, signifying nothing. All the world's a stage. And life, you know, struts upon the stage, fretting, etc. Exactly right, exactly right. So what we've been saying here in this video is completely revolutionary, isn't it? Utterly revolutionary. And if it was easy to get to this point, many would have gotten to it, actually. So don't be worried that you may be struggling with it. Anyone can get it. But then they might say, yeah, but, you know, and it's like, and it seems like clouds return. You can't get it well enough to share it clearly. You may get it, but when you try to share it clearly, you can't quite do it. No, that's okay. It's very difficult to... difficult in that it requires long-term persistence to clear the clouds out. But that doesn't mean that you can't get it and practice it. Absolutely you can. It's not everybody's role to do this sort of thing, videos and sharing it. So it's enough to get it as far as practicing it. Love the faithfulness of each moment. Let's put it that way. Love the faithfulness of each moment. Everyone can practice that. And that will automatically bring one to the point of willingness to choose a new idea, which will then enable one to sidestep the troubles that mind is presenting with this simulation of prepping for time. Absolutely. You don't have to be doing videos or sharing clearly this whole plan of sidestepping. Just that you're able to practice it enough to a point where you say, you know what, I'm leaning in this direction. That's enough. That's enough. So again, don't worry if you say, I don't know, I'm afraid I can't present this, I don't know how to present. That's okay. Because that's difficult, I'm telling you. That is really difficult. I've had just an incredibly difficult time. It's required enormous continual efforts. For instance, like this channel has, what, I don't know how many videos, 370 or something, and then another one had like 100 or whatever, but before that I had a channel with hundreds of videos, maybe another 300 or whatever, and before that, before there was the internet, I made 55 VHS videos, incredible videos I made. It's too bad I destroyed them all, really, but you know what, it's a good thing, because otherwise I might have been caught up in trying to present those and stuff, and that would have wasted time. It was a continual effort, and actually before that, I for years and years and years, I taped every single morning. I had a video camera in my room, and I taped, and I had hundreds of tapes full up, mini cassette tapes. That was before we used the digital recording. Hundreds of tapes, hundreds and hundreds of hours of every morning I get up and I do a little talk in the morning. I destroyed all those tapes too. I threw them all away. Which is also a good thing, because we're not trying to present my life here and archiving it and all this nonsense. We're trying to escape the troubles right now. So we're not worried about the past. We're worried about right now, this video. Okay, so that just shows you the amount of prep I've done for this, and just working constantly on concepts and words and clarification in books before that, studying nonstop. So it's just been a complete nonstop effort, very intense. You could say I've done thousands of hours of taping, really, and practicing, you know, sharing information with people, always practicing, trying to release this information the best I can find, whatever is the best I can find to share it with the world, practicing that over and over and over and over and over. In many ways. So it's not easy at all to share this information clearly. There are all sorts of, like, reverberations and doubts and stuff. And, well, you know, if it was easy, we'd all be doing it. So, again, one does not have to do that. To sidestep the troubles. To choose to prep for timelessness. That's all you have to do. All you have to do is just say, okay, I want to prep for timelessness. It's no big deal. I mean, it's just, you know, I can do that because I trust mind. But first, we have to trust mind. To trust mind, we have to love the faithfulness of mind to the idea that we are, that we gave mind right now, that we're experiencing. Love that. Love the faithfulness. You know, we call it hate the sin but love the sinner. Okay, love the faithfulness of mind. You can hate all this prepping. Hey, yeah, of course, it's terrible. Hate it, absolutely hate it. But I love the faithfulness of mine. Just that one thing. So, we will see what happens next. I don't know. I really have no idea. I don't have any set plan at all of what to do. I don't even know what's going to happen in, you know, the next few minutes. So, but we're really knocking on the door by this fresh game changer perspective, which I presented in previous videos in bits and pieces, but now it's becoming more cohesive. It's becoming much more cohesive. The context is becoming very cohesive, which is a good sign. It's a very good sign. So I'm not even sure what needs to be said anymore. I think I've said it all. I'm just, at some point, I guess you have to realize that you've got it. And the only confusion that arises when you try to figure out, well, what more do I need to say? And there isn't anything more that needs to be said. So that has to be recognized, too. If your clarification reaches a point where you're entirely clear what more clarification you need, you try to find it, you'll feel lost. You say, I can't find it. Well, where is it? It's because you already have it. Already have the clarification. So sometimes you just have to rest, you know, and just say, okay, got it. And we can reiterate the situation. Love it the way it is. Love the faithfulness of the moment. Love the faithfulness of the moment. That doesn't mean you're going to be stuck with these moments of prepping for time. It doesn't mean that at all, just the opposite. The more you love the faithfulness of the moment, the less stuck you are to it. Because the more you feel you can choose a new idea. And that's what Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment said, is when you love the faithfulness of the moment, you feel free of it. You feel there's a freedom, a spaciousness, a feeling like you're not really stuck to it anymore. And the more you hate it, the more actually you feel stuck with it. Because the more unfaithfulness you feel, the more you think that mind's being unfaithful to the idea that you gave it. So therefore you're trapped and don't dare try to choose something different, because you think you'd have a void then, functional annihilation. So hate the content of the state of mind, but love the faithfulness of the mind to the idea. And that then frees one up. So we could practice this. I might do something like that. I don't know. I really don't know. I could go through the headlines, the news headlines, you know, and look at the headline and say, thank you, mind, for your perfect faithfulness, fidelity. Thank you, mind, for being so faithful to the idea I gave you. I love your faithfulness on this. Oh, here's another story. I love your faithfulness on this. Oh, they're releasing chemical weapons. Oh, I love your faithfulness, mind, on this issue. Wow, what incredible evidence of faithfulness. Thank you so much. I love your faithfulness. Love your faithfulness. And just go over all these stories. You see how that would completely change the paradigm, wouldn't it? Completely change the paradigm. I wish more this was happening all over the world, but it's not. It's not. Which is, again, I love that. Love the faithfulness of mind where you're deceiving everybody. Now, getting free of deception is not a lack of faithfulness on the part of mind, because keep in mind, it's the Holy Spirit that's informing me. See, it's not the mind. The mind is not telling me this stuff. No, it's not. It's the Holy Spirit. So unless you're actually listening to the Holy Spirit, you will continue to be deceived. So most of the world is not. So of course you have a world full of deception. Say, thank you, mind, for showing me how faithful you are to... How faithful you are to the idea. See, the Holy Spirit, being a special creation of the Prime Creator, is faithful to reality, is not being asked to present ideas to us. It is presenting clarity about how reality functions to us. Okay, but it's not, so we don't say, Holy Spirit, present an idea to me. No, we say, Holy Spirit, present clarity to me about how reality functions. And Holy Spirit will do that. So the Holy Spirit is not being faithless when it tells us to choose a new idea. Absolutely not. It's telling us this is how reality functions. Waiting for the tomatoes to ripen. That's basically where we're at. Waiting for the tomatoes to ripen. I've got hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of tomatoes ripening. And I'm just waiting for them to ripen. Again, trying to deal with scarcity by getting massive amounts. I saw someone once had this big barrel, 50-gallon barrel, it was full of golf balls. You know, I said, what's going on? He said, yeah, I found all of these while playing golf. And it's like, God, it's unbelievable how many golf balls he had, you know. And, of course, it wasn't enough. And it was a character of getting, wanting to get more. So, I have a lot of golf balls I collected. I find them, but I tend to bring them to the range and use them on the range. Just hit them, you know, good golf balls. I say, but I don't need all these extra golf balls. It's ridiculous. And hoarders, you know, you see the hoarders, you know, their houses are floor to ceiling. I had that one time. Guitars, never could have enough guitars. Always had to get another one. You know, used one, it didn't matter what it was. It could be a cheap one, $15, you know, $35. I said, I gotta get that guitar, I just have to. They said, that guitar is going to be the one. I was sure of it. I said, that one, absolutely, when I play that guitar, I'm going to feel satisfied. It's enough, I know it. So I'd get it, for a little while, I said, yeah, it's almost got it. And then it would just seem to slip away. I said, I didn't quite get it, it was right there. And then my eye would get another guitar and say, okay, that's the one. And it would just go on and on and on and on like that. It's terrible. Same with the song. This song is going to do it for me. Now the next one. Almost. Next one. Food. Also, this ice cream. This bowl of ice cream is going to just hit the spot. And then you say, oh, it almost hit the spot. and then another bowl. And just one more bowl. That's why they sing, one drink, just one more, and then another. Put the bottle on the table. Let it stay there till I'm not able to see your face in every place that I go. I keep trying to forget, but I haven't forgot as yet. So one drink of wine, and you're still on my mind. Well, one drink, just one more, and then another. Well, then another. Addiction. I wonder why. We're all addicts. Prepping for time, we're all addicts, actually. Everyone. In one way or the other. So love the faithfulness of the mind. Mind, thank you. Love your faithfulness. Just love the faithfulness. I'm miserable. I love the faithfulness of this misery. And this is such a different way of functioning that it seems just like, huh? You know, are you kidding? That's how I felt in Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment. I said, are you kidding? You want me to love how I feel? I feel terrible. And the book said, yeah, but you will continue to feel terrible until you decide to love the faithfulness of that terribleness, how you feel. And it's right. I've continued to feel terrible. Because instead of trying to change it, don't try to change it. Just love it the way, love the faithfulness of that misery. Say, mind, I love your faithfulness. Mind, I love your faithfulness. Just speak directly to mind. You say, mind, I love your faithfulness. Don't say, oh, I just love this misery. No, say, mind, I love your faithfulness in this misery. I love the evidence that you're presenting here. Wonderful. Thank you so much for reminding me that you have no choice but to be faithful to the idea that I give you. You've got no choice. Thank you for reminding me. Now the blues, whether it's black blues or white man's blues, which is really country music, or whatever, who's ever presenting the blues have always been with us. The music, it's basically singing about addiction, really. It's more real, whereas a lot of the pop music is singing about, oh, I feel so wonderful, I'm in love, you know, I'm in love. Whereas country music is like singing, it's really poor man white blues, and poor men and women, every children, everybody who's in, I was in the blues from the get-go, and it's saying, oh God, I'm so addicted, this is just terrible, I hate this addiction, yeah, it's a terrible addiction, I just can't kick this addiction, that's what it's about. The misery of existence. My baby left her, you know, left her Jingling John for Fold and Fred. True love never backed up a word that she said. Meaning, you know, I didn't have enough. She saw someone had more. She's gone. She's gone forever. Here I sit on the back row in a church down the street, not so far from the place where we used to meet, and it's finally getting through to me she's found somebody new. So here I sit in the church while she weds another man. You know, I never dreamed that I'd still be sitting here after all these years. And so saying she found somebody who had more, and I lost her, kind of thing. And oh, you know, so upset, saying, how do I get more? I didn't have enough. It's never enough, never enough. So it's basically saying, it's never enough. I'm addicted, and all this stuff. So it's in some ways, it's very helpful to listen and say, what are they singing about? They're so unhappy. They're so miserable. They're so miserable. Ah, my baby, she done me wrong. You know, why? Well, Folding Fred came along. In other words, he had the paper money instead of the coin money. My baby told me, honey, you're poor, but I love you. And I could be happy just living in a little old shack. She seemed real happy with my front pocket jingling money. Until the grapevine told her Folding Fred was back. Gone. That baby left her jingling John for Folding Fred. True love never backed up a world word that she said. That only proves that a blackberry is green when it's red. My baby left her jingling John for Folding Fred. Again, reminding you, hey, you know, the scarcity, we hate the scarcity. We want more. We want more, we want more. It's never enough. Whatever I have, I know she's going to leave me. She's going to leave. She's going to leave. Sees more somewhere. I need more. He said, thank you. I'd be happy just living in a little old shack. Well, that's getting the jingle of the coins, getting something, and then later on, oh, here's more. Oh, I want this more. And so we're all struggling. Oh, I don't want to lose what I've got. I'm afraid I'm going to lose what I've got. And of course, companies, they want more money. The stockholders want bigger dividends. So you have a job at a company, you're getting older, and you've got all these pensions and benefits and medical, you have a higher salary stuff. And the management's saying, you know what? We could be a much more efficient and profitable company if we just axe these 500 bin management jobs, right? There's a bunch of old people there, they're making too much. Let me fill this with some young college graduates, etc. You know, axed. And what happens? The company makes more money, and the dividend, the stockholders, and they get better dividends. They're richer. What do they do? They can buy more stuff, take more vacations, buy more homes, more cars, more clothes, go out to dine fancier restaurants, etc., etc. Send their kids to better colleges. You name it. Okay, so it's all about getting more. And so no matter how much you have, you're feeling that somebody is going to undermine you. And because they want more. They want more. And they're looking to find a way to move you out of the picture so they can get what you got and even more, and et cetera, et cetera. So it's a tooth and claw. Social Darwinism is very true. Bloody in tooth and fat and tooth and claw. Crab mentality, just in pulling anybody down who tries to get up, pull them down. I want more. Good grief, you know. So, and just say, thank you, mind, so much. I love your faithfulness to the idea that I gave you of presenting this ghastly nightmare of prepping for annihilation. This feeling of I'm losing. I don't have what I am. What I am is slipping away because spirit is complete. So, of course, if we were prepping for annihilation of spirit, we feel it as slipping away. It's slipping through my fingers. Something is slipping through my fingers. It's a feeling like I can't grasp it. It's slipping. No matter how tightly I grasp it, it's slipping through my fingers. The sand is slipping through. I'm losing something. I don't know. No matter how much I get, I still feel I'm losing something, you know. And the people get old, the super rich people get old, they act like crazy. They spend, they say, oh my God, I have all the money in the world, I have billions of dollars, and yet, you know, I feel like I'm just, everything is slipping away, I'm losing everything. You know, and they desperately, you know, they marry a 25-year-old or something, and they have to feel like I gotta keep it from slipping away, and they can't do it, and they're like freaked out, scared, and shocked by it all. You know, terrible, it's terrible. And say, thank you, mind, for being so faithful to this, with the idea I gave you of this slipping away. Loss, 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 loss. Today is slipping away. Today is slipping away. And it is absolutely futile to try and practice this happiness thing. Like, oh, I'm just grateful to God for the tricks. That is mine again, playing tricks with you, deceiving you. All that stuff. Power of positive thinking, the secret, all these things, that's mine, is just tricking, deceiving you. Saying, no, you can figure out a way to be happy with this. Just be mindful, you know, like hearing the chimes. Oh, those nice chimes. I like the chimes right now. I like the sun. The sun is really nice right there. The tree, the tree is right there. It's a beautiful tree. I'm so happy there's a beautiful tree here. Yeah. Mindfulness, kind of, that's all mental deception. That's deception of the mind. Saying the mind can be unfaithful to the idea that it gave. No. The basic, fundamental, underlying feeling is loss and scarcity and dislike. We feel we're losing ourselves. We don't like that. There's no way to like that feeling. It's impossible. So don't struggle to try and like it. Instead, say, I love the fidelity to this idea. I hate how it feels, but I love the fidelity. That we can do. So don't be kind of a pagan. A pagan is someone who's trying to learn to love this scenario, we call it. That's a good definition. Someone who lacks faith is trying to learn to love this scenario. That is deception. That makes things worse. Builds greater fear, and then greater attack and misery and trauma comes. A greater prepping comes from that fear. Absolutely. So a person of real faith says, I love the faithfulness of mind to the idea that I gave. Wonderful faithfulness. Look at this. So horrible. So absolutely horrible. This tree rains down dead branches and stuff. I have to rake it up constantly. It's filthy, dirties everything up. One day it might, you know, come down in a storm. It is a monstrosity. And it's just what a pain, you know. The sun, it's getting colder now. It's not giving me the right temperature. I don't like it. So it's okay to grumble about everything. Nothing is good. This tan bark, it gets on the walkway. It doesn't blend with the other stuff. It's a nuisance. You know, this. All these nuisances. This bottle is soon going to be empty, and I got to get another one. And how come, you know, it doesn't just refill itself automatically? I'm tired. I gotta go to sleep. I gotta get up and work. And blah blah blah. Grumble. That's more realistic. That is being more true to a situation. Don't pretend to be someone who knows the art of living. Say, I have mastered the art of living, and I am happy. I know how to be happy. Utter nonsense. That is totally caught up in the delusion of mind. Totally. So, by all means, grumble. Be unhappy. But actually then say, hey, I'm actually extraordinarily, I just love, I have great gratitude and relief. You might call it, I'm so relieved that mind is faithful to the idea I gave it. I'm so relieved. Yeah, I hate the weather, but I'm so relieved that mind is faithful to the idea that I gave. So relieved. So it's a relief, a gratitude, a relief, like, oh, I can choose a new idea. That's safe to do. So that's what we need to be practicing. We don't need to be trying to figure out how to be happy, how to decorate our home so we're happy, how to remodel, how to decorate, how to live a lifestyle. You know, we got all these lifestyle magazines. You know, what utter nonsense, you know. I just need to get the right cigars. I need to have the right wine cellar. I need to have the right wet bar. I need to have the, you know, right, you know, countertops. I need to have the right floor. I need to listen to the right jazz or something. I need the right music. I need to know from all these experts telling me how to live the right lifestyle. You know, all these lifestyle magazines, you know, what utter nonsense. And shows. I need to cook the right food. I need to be able to cook this right recipe, you know. What am I going to eat tonight? Probably I'll microwave some Trader Joe's organic brown rice, and I'll have some squash from the garden, and that's it. So I'm not really looking forward to that at all. I'm not really looking forward to it at all. And so, but again, so relieved that mine is faithful. That gives me all sorts of problems, unsolvable problems. Thank you. Wonderful. Wonderful fidelity. I go into a store and look at, I can't eat this, I can't eat that, and I go through the whole store and I realize there's nothing in the store I can eat. Terrible. Traumatic. I say, oh, thank you. Thank you, mind, for presenting such a nasty problem that just proves how faithful you are. So there we go. There we go. Don't worry if you're a grumbler. That's better than being a pretender. The pretenders pretending that they're happy. That's pretense. Or pretending that they're going to be happy. That's pretense. The realizers have chosen a new idea. They're prepping for timelessness, and they have a different quality about them altogether. Absolutely different quality. It's unmistakable. Unmistakable. Those who are merely great pretenders at happiness, and those who actually are prepping for timelessness, unmistakable different quality. And of course, you can, if you want, if you're deceived, that's because you want to be. That's time, mind again. Say, thank you, mind, for deceiving me. It shows, proves your fidelity. Thank you, mind, for deceiving me. Thank you for so much dollar deception. But really, the quality is different. It's discernible. It is absolutely discernible. Because there's no sense of trying to master anything. There's no sense of trying to learn the an art of living, being artful in your life, or anything like that. Present is a present is a feeling of no scarcity at all. Complete, right now, this moment, I am entirely complete. And I'm not even thinking about the next moment or this moment or that moment. I am fulfilled right this very moment. That's the quality. And notion of it could be any otherwise, that type of thing. So, there you go. That's it, in a nutshell. Rapid advancement necessary because of rapid advancement in the world right now. The prepping for annihilation is... The step into time is going on unabated. As expected, not a surprise. And it's really now so much that we're not even able to react to it anymore. We reach a point where we're overwhelmed because we simply can't be giving a strong reaction to everything. It's just too much. It's just all angles. And we just say, oh my God. It's time for Gog and Magog, you know. Gog is pretty close to G-O-O-G, isn't it? Absolutely, Gog and Magog. Interesting. We're getting goggly at this time, or googly at this time. It's all getting very googly or goggly. Thank you, mind, for the. I'm so relieved of your fidelity to the idea I gave you. All right, I'm so relieved at the fidelity, of your fidelity to the idea I gave you. I'm so relieved. Thank you for all this trouble. I'm so relieved that you're. That you're faithful to the idea that I gave you. Still perfectly faithful. I'm so relieved at that. I'm so relieved. I'm so relieved. I feel such a relief. I feel a great relief that of the faithfulness to the idea I gave you. Thank you, mind. You're perfect. You're flawless. Greatly relieved. Greatly relieved. Greatly relieved. Like that. Greatly relieved. See, this, you say, this is a different road you're going down, right? So, in sidestepping the troubles, you go down a different road. You're going to go down a different road. And at first, the road seems strange because you haven't gone down that road before. At first, you said, wow, I didn't know there was even a road here. But I actually had a dream like that where there was all this going down a road, and there was all this construction, and it was being torn up. The whole road was torn up, I'm telling you. Big time, absolutely torn up, and cones everywhere, and we were being... The cars are being kind of detoured. It was actually a traffic jam. It was a snarled gridlock. It was horrible. And suddenly I looked over, And I saw this nice little country road. I saw this little road there. And I said, hey, there's nobody on that road. There's no construction here. It's smooth, beautiful. And I said, and I turned onto this road and started going down that road. And I looked back, nobody else was going on the road. They're all in gridlock, all freaking out, saying, wow, what's going on? You know, and I said, oh, they're in big trouble. So there is a road, but it's not a road well-traveled, and we're unfamiliar with it. So it seems kind of odd, strange at first. We say, thank you. I'm so relieved. I'm so greatly relieved, Maya, your fidelity to the idea I gave you. I'm so relieved. That is starting to go down a different road. And it's that different road that is the sidestepping to the troubles that are coming. The gridlock. What's coming is a gridlock. A type of global gridlock, as it were, is what's coming. That is what's coming. And people know it. People know it. You probably know it. It's an overall type of, with many angles, a feeling of just, we're just stuck. We're in gridlock. We can't get out of our own way. We're in our own way. We're living in our own filth. We're just totally seized up and can't function, cannot make it. Where it's just, it'll get into us, you know, so bad. But there's this side road here. You just turn out of that road and say, I'm so relieved, mind, at your faithfulness to the idea I gave you. I'm so relieved. Ah, gridlock, I'm so relieved, mind, of this idea that you're faithful to the idea I gave you. So relieved. I'm so relieved that I'm willing to now go on the side road and choose another idea for you. Bingo. You see? And you're on that other road. So at first it seems strange. I'm so relieved. I'm so relieved at your faithfulness, mind, to the idea I gave you. I'm so relieved, mind, that you're faithful to the idea I gave you. I'm so relieved in any situation, you know, another war or something. Oh, I'm so relieved, mind. More trouble and whatever. I'm so relieved about this trouble, mind, and your faithfulness, the idea I gave you. Such great relief. I'm just experiencing such great relief. And keep telling yourself that I'm experiencing great relief. So maybe as far as a declaration, if you want to take a declaration out of this video, say, I am experiencing great relief at your faithfulness, mind, to the idea I gave you. I am experiencing great relief. Now, you may not experience it right this moment, but you're telling yourself that it's okay to experience great relief, and that great relief will come. So I am experiencing great relief, profound and great relief, mind, over your faithfulness to the idea that I gave you. Wonderful trouble you're presenting. Thank you. Wonderful, wonderfully faithful trouble you're presenting. And I'm greatly relieved at this. I'm feeling great relief. I'm feeling great relief. I'm feeling great relief. So again, I'm feeling great relief. Now I'm feeling this great relief. Great and sustained relief. I'm feeling this great and sustained relief over your faithfulness, mind, to the idea that I gave you. Wonderful. I'm so relieved. I'm feeling great relief. I'm experiencing great relief. I'm feeling great relief right now. Wonderful, sustained relief. I'm experiencing wonderful and sustained relief right now, mind, over your great, perfect fidelity to the idea I gave you. So there you go. There's a declaration that to end the video, we'll end with these declarations. I'm experiencing this profound relief. I'm so profoundly relieved. I am so profoundly relieved. Finally, I'm experiencing this great relief. And did I not say that around June 30th of this year, we will experience some type of profound relief? That is what was shown to me in a dream. So that this declaration is prepping us for that profound relief, and we may very well get this profound relief, because we are now saying, thank you, I'm experiencing this great relief right now. I'm experiencing this wonderful, sustained, great relief, profound, deep, great relief. And now we know why, because mind has been totally faithful to the idea we gave it. See, the context is there. So we may very well experience a profound relief coming up within, you know, what's it, 25 days, as a matter of fact. 25 days, give or take a little bit, wiggle room there, but we're right on track for it. We are right on track for it at this very moment. So, excellent. Time for dinner. All right, very great. Declare, I am feeling such profound relief right now. I am feeling such profound relief. Thank you, mind, for being totally faithful to the idea that I gave you. That's it. All right.